Hello, welcome to Chairside Live. I'm Megan Strong.
And I'm Will Schmidt, registered dental assistant here at Gladwell Dental.
And we're so happy you're with us today because Dr. Chi, he's restoring a fractured all ceramic restoration on number 14 with BruxZir NOW.
That's right. And he's going through the clinical steps of preparation and delivery. Today we're going to see him prepare, design, mill, and fabricate a BruxZir NOW crown in just under 1 hour.
Let's see it.
In this episode, I'm going to dive into more detail for the same-day BruxZir crown case I introduced in episode 255. To recap, my patient presented with a fractured all-ceramic restoration on his upper left first molar. The existing restoration is a crown lay, which is a more conservative full cuspal coverage restoration without as much axial coverage like a full coverage crown. This has become a popular restorative option among the chairside CAD/CAM community since we're able to restore large, non-retentive preparations immediately. This was a really great restoration that served the patient for quite a while. With most all-ceramic restorations, we can pretty much assume they're bonded in adhesively, so often requiring multiple slots to reach the prep beneath. Here I'm using a Zircator burr from Golden Dental to create 3 slots through the restoration. The burr's designed for removing zirconia, but also works really well with other strong glass-based ceramics. After the slots are created, I use a Christensen crown removal tool to then separate the sections off the tooth. There's usually one remaining piece that, if small enough, it can be separated by gently running the burr along the interface. By air drying the tooth, you can also get a better visualization of any remaining cement, which I prefer removing to have a fresh tooth surface to cement to. Anytime we're replacing an old restoration, it's time to evaluate what other defects exist to see if it will be included in the external outline of our prep. Since there's a large buccal effraction, I decide to prep the buccal to include that in the final restoration. The cool thing is the lesion created a nice deep 1 millimeter chamfered margin, which is my preferred margin design for any CAD/CAM restoration. I'm using a coarse grit 856014 round-ended tapered diamond burr to reduce the buccal to a depth that blends in with the effraction and also to connect to the finish line of the original prep. The round-ended burr helps establish a rounded internal angle at the gingival axial wall transition. On the occlusal, I do want to establish an appropriate amount of clearance, but first I blend in some of the depth cuts I made during the initial sectioning of that defective restoration. Since it's nearly impossible to visually tell how much reduction or clearance we have on our prep, I like to use a Kerr flexible clearance tab in a 1.5 millimeter thickness. With the tab positioned over the prep and the patient biting together, I try sliding the tab out. If there's any resistance, I'll need to reduce more. To determine where to reduce, we add a piece of articulating paper between the clearance tab and the prep to mark on the tooth where we're underprepared. I like shooting for 1.5 millimeters of clearance since it will provide room to design an anatomically correct restoration with adequate material thickness for strength. When I'm finished making the bulk reduction on the axial and occlusal surfaces, I try to round over the internal line angles with a football or round burr to minimize any internal stress along our restoration. I also like to run a perio probe along the margins to evaluate the reduction and smoothness. The probe provides a great tactile feedback of these two aspects along this critical area of our preparation. If I lose an apical stop, I know I haven't created at least 0.5 millimeter of reduction, and if I feel any roughness, I'll want to smooth these areas to establish a good seal between the restoration and the prep. On the mesial area, the translucent roof of the pulp chamber is visible. Since we're close, I'll place a thin layer of Vitrobron glass ionomer for added protection. Glass ionomer does chemically bond to tooth structure, but I like to do a quick acid rinse to remove the smear layer. In this case, I use 37% phosphoric acid for 5 seconds and rinse that off. I'll then place a 1 minute application of Gluma desensitizer, suction off any excess, then apply the glass ionomer. The final prep resembles a full coverage crown on the buckle, but I actually didn't prep much more away from the original lingual margin position. I tried preserving as much healthy tooth structure as possible, and with the chairside mill, it does allow me to restore indirect restorations immediately without necessarily prepping for a provisional. An area that I should have actually prepared more away on was at the distal margin. Ideally, we should create 0.5 millimeter of separation between the prep and adjacent teeth. For digital impressions, less than 0.5 millimeter of separation increases the chance of bridging on the digital model, and with conventional PVS impressions, there could also be a distortion, tear, or void in the material from that area being too thin. So make sure there's adequate separation to make life easier on yourself or on your technicians. Speaking of making things easier on technicians, if your margins are subgingival, some sort of gingival retraction must be used. Otherwise, margin identification at best becomes a guesstimate. Here I'm using a single core technique with a size 1 along the buckle and a size 2 on the mesial. I allow the cords to sit for at least 5 minutes, then gently pull the cords while they're wet right before I take the digital impression. I wet the cords and remove them gently to reduce the likelihood of any bleeding. Once I verify that I've achieved the appropriate amount of retraction, I dry the area well, then begin the digital impression using the iTero element. The first scan is a high-resolution scan of the preparation. For the prep, upper and lower quadrant scans, I begin each scan on the occlusal, then rotate to the lingual and buccal to capture those contours and areas beneath the height of contours. With the scanner resting on the adjacent teeth, I focus on the screen where I can see the live view of what the camera sees on the lower left to help stay centered on the teeth, and I also observe the digital model build in the middle as I move the camera along the different surfaces. Once the digital impression is captured of the prep, opposing, and bite, the data is transferred to the lab of my choice. In this case, it's sent to my Glidewell in-office design station. The first step in the Fast Design software is margin marking. The margin is designated by the red dotted line. I rotate the model around to ensure the line is marked correctly. If the prep has a sharp finish line and adequate retraction in subgingival areas, this step should be completed very quickly. Once the margins are set, the software generates a functional and aesthetic design that fits the restorative space. Clinicians can easily control any area of the design to fit the patient's needs. Prior to sending the design to the mill, I check and dial in the proximal and occlusal contacts, the values that work best for my system. Incredibly, the entire design process typically takes less than 3 minutes. I'm so grateful to the 60 software developers that dedicated over 700 man years to create this very easy to use design software. When the design is complete, how does a 35-minute turnaround time for a fully centered BruxZir crown sound? It kind of is unbelievable and shouldn't even be possible, but I'm amazed every time after I lock a BruxZir NOW block into my fast mill, I get a perfect fitting BruxZir crown that's ready to be delivered. On the milled BruxZir, I snap the crown at the thinnest point of the sprue and smooth the residual down with a fine grit red stripe diamond burr. At this point, I'll seat the crown and check the proximal contacts. Since I've found a contact value on the software that works for me, I normally have very little to no need to make adjustments to these areas. After evaluating the margins with an explorer and a bite wing radiograph, I'll check the bite for any heavy contacts. When making adjustments to lab or chairside BruxZir, we recommend using fine grit diamonds to limit the amount of surface roughness. Following any adjustments, polishing the restoration is recommended to ensure the adjusted surfaces are as smooth as possible. Here I'm using the ASAP polishing kit by Clinician's Choice that is designed to work really well on any restorative material. These polishing wheels will be included in the new BruxZir polishing kit that I'll detail in a future episode. Prior to delivering the crown, I scrub a thin layer of Gluma desensitizer on the prep and allow it to sit for at least a minute. The solution will help disinfect the tooth and reduce the chances of postoperative sensitivity. At this point to deliver the crown, any conventional cement or resin cement of your choice may be used with this BruxZir NOW material. For this delivery, we're using 3M's Resin Modified Glass Ionomer Rely Excluding Plus. It's very easy to use with a pretty quick cleanup. After the crown is cemented, it's always a good idea to check the occlusal contacts again. And there you have it. Zero compromise for an immediate BruxZir crown using the Glidewell in-office solution. If you'd like to learn more, please visit glidewell.io or glidewelldental.com. I look forward to sharing more of the powerful ways we can use the system in future episodes. Thanks for tuning in. Back to you, Megan and Will.
Well, thank you so much for that, Dr. Chi.
And if you'd like more information on the glidewell.io in-office solution, you can head to glidewell.io. But that wraps it up for today's episode. So on behalf of everyone here at Glidewell Dental, thank you so much for watching.
And we'll meet you right back here next time.